5 seconds to go. Start. I am happy to address you on the occasion of the inauguration of the first ever assembly meeting of the Global Environment Facility. It is indeed fitting that the first assembly meeting of this international cooperative venture should be held in the developing world, and that too in India. The 20th century has witnessed major developments which have momentous impact not only on the lives of human beings but also on planet Earth. These include an unprecedented growth in population and in consumption, rapidly increasing urbanization, dramatic changes in the global economic system, and the revolution in communication technology. As we are poised on the threshold of the third millennium, we have become increasingly aware that the process of development, including industrialization and economic growth, have come at a huge cost to society, to the environment, and to our future. In some ways, it is ironical that some of the achievements of the 20th century themselves pose the challenges for the 21st century. With almost 6 billion people inhabiting this earth and the global GDP approaching $30 trillion, the pace of human and economic activity is putting pressure on global life support systems. We witness the depletion of non-renewable natural resources, the continued destruction of life-sustaining forests, and illegal international trade in protected species of flora and fauna. There is an ongoing depletion of our planet's biological treasures, and the threat of an acceleration in global warming and in the greenhouse effect. In short, there is a rapid globalization of environmental destruction. The environmental impact of human activity is no longer restricted to man-made national boundaries. The problems of environmental degradation call for more than scientific and technological solution. They require the re-establishment of environmental ethics and values practiced in traditional societies, with economic development based on these issues. India, as one of the traditional societies, has always believed in the integrity and sacredness of nature, with all pervading peace as the ultimate purpose of all existence and activity. The age-old philosophy of coexistence is not one merely for coexistent of human beings, but it is in fact a basic premise of all living beings and of harmony within the cosmos. The balance of nature has to be restored, even as we have to ensure complementary and coexistent of different life forms between plants and animals and between nature and man. Based on our experience and understanding of global environment today, that sustainable development at the national level cannot be pursued in isolation. Quality of life of the nations today, as also in the future, depends to very large extent on the policies and actions that the fellow nations of the world pursue. Against this background, new partnerships have to be established for conservation and sustainable development while ensuring equitable distribution of technology and social advancement. Promoting these partnerships require making the most of the diverse bunch of knowledge, skill perceptions, and of assets belonging to a wide cross section of nations and societies. When we analyze the nature of pollutants, we find that both effluence and poverty contribute to their high levels. The problems of the industrialized and the developed world stem from their high levels of economic activity and consumption. The degeneration of forests and natural resources in the developing countries, on the other hand, can be attributed largely to the lack of resources and alternative source of energy and income generation. The strategies to tackle these two distinct causes, therefore, need to be significantly different. In the case of the rich and developed world, the issues can be best handled by laying stringent commission norms, limits on pollutants, and by enforcing these stringent norms and limitations. However, for the developing and the underdeveloped world, the best approach would be to put into place an incentive structure that would encourage conservation and discourage the scavenging of nature without compromising economic development and rapid alleviation of poverty. For the developing countries, we should make concerted efforts to facilitate and promote adoption of environment-friendly techniques of production and also undertake far greater measures to disseminate information about ill effects of polluting forces. As part of international efforts to contain the ill effects of environmental degradation and to encourage sustainable development, nations have put in place several ecological treaties like the Montreal Protocol, the Framework Convention on Climate Change. Although much attention seems to be focused on climate change, on global warming and ozone layer, very little is being done to address the environmental problems facing poor societies, whether it be paucity of clean drinking water or poor sanitary conditions. Let me reiterate that if we are committed to successfully address the challenges of sustainable development and hence of environmental conservation, then it will require an international movement the like of which has never been seen before. It will require effective integration of the sporadic efforts being made by the different players, whether it be international organizations, national government or non-governmental as such. Stop.